Unfortunately, I need to speak in English because it's much more easy and convenient and less error prone. So let's try. So everyone, I think, that have the experience to pay on some payment terminal in general, they are widely used, and the number of payment terminals are really increased. We are talking about millions as comparable to not to mobile phone world, but yes, it's still a growing market where a lot of companies, let's say most of the two big are Verifone and Ingenico. They produce constantly new payment terminal. What happened is that basically the user experience or the way that we interact with the standard mobile phone let even this market moving forward to new kind of user experience and user interaction. So of course, more user experience, more user interaction, more security problems. So now basically devices are moving on smart POS. There are some kind, we don't have all in the market mobile POS, but we have even complex smart POS based basically on Android world. So what the technology is moving is they choose, right now, they choose Android as a technology to increase the user experience. It means that the device will not pay only. We just give the capability to install on top of the devices what is usually called value added applications. So some applications that allow you to do a lot of stuff, like, I don't know, it's order a taxi or choose your room, choose your dish, play casino and so on. And there are a lot of technology. Someone is still working on, let's say, pin entry on standard keyboards. Someone moving on pin on glass, and everything's that every times that we have some new, let's say, kind of payment terminals in the market, as you can see, there is a new standard for security. This is some let's say they call it PCI PTS. You can go on the internet and download any document you want. But basically, there is a constant update of this this kind of security and description. How much should be a device should be secure? Of course, this is a kind of IoT. They are connected now to the internet using a VA application. They can connect it to like standard services on the net, and not only is in the happening in the past only to the bank provider, but even to other kind of services. So, what happened? We need to rely that these devices can install third-party apps. Yeah, we can vetting the apps, we can go to the code and so on, but it's clear that any kind of security that we put on the devices, you can have like some kind of attack that are not based on the security of the security of the devices, but is basically is the data flow that can inject security flow in your app itself. So it's not the protocol security, but it's the sequence of bytes that you send, and so it's not really, you can find application that you can vetting, you can take a look on it, you think that is perfectly correct and perfectly working. But then they get some flow based on the data they receive. And there are a lot of kind of tools, research about fuzzy techniques to inject problem in security problem inside devices. So, and what is the problems that, okay, HTML5, I know that everyone has a mobile phone and you can see that Chrome or libchromium is constantly updated. But bank love HTML5 for very added applications. So payment terminal usually has a constantly update of Chromium, Google Chromium library for supporting properly HTML5. And then there is, okay, in mobile phone world you can trigger a note update, let's say, quickly. in the payment terminal world, it takes maybe 1 year to have an OTA, or depends on how much is critical the bug. Let's say that we cannot expect more than 3 releases a year for a payment terminal. So we need to pay attention what is going to be released in the market. Okay. Okay, what we are going, how can I try to address problems about security? So we can work on security boot, okay, trust zone, okay. And then we have like security CPU. So it means that a certified CPU to be PCI compliance, where we can store transactions, let running the payment, let's say payment kernel or part of the payment application inside the security CPU. We can enforce hardening process on top of the Android devices. We can do application write restriction. We can do application network restriction. And then we can properly isolate apps according to their domain. It's a valid other applications. It receives some specific Linux domain. It's a payment application. It can receive another Linux domain. Problem is behind is that suppose that your payment flow is perfectly secure using trust zone and security CPU, but your terminal is used as a source to attack other system. So for PCI, PTS, or for SRC Lab, it's not a good thing that if you're booting image or your devices is a source of attack of other websites, send emails or whatever. So we need to really work on top of it to avoid all this threat. Okay, scope of the talk, okay, security boot. I talk about a bit of security boot, hardware security, network security on connected devices, introduction of Linux. Why? Because all of those techniques are usually applied to increase the security of a payment terminal. In general, you can adopt these techniques to even in home automation. Okay, the cost increase. Basically, to secure a payment terminal costs a lot of money in terms of times, in terms of resources, in terms of QA, in terms of testing, okay. But some of these techniques can be reapplied to any, let's say, smart IoT devices. Not very small, but some kind of a platform that can receive some of these features. Okay. What is security boot? We need basically to assure that our boot chain is secure. Boot chain is secure, means starting from the boot ROM up to the file system that is usually mounted in read-only. And okay, if the boot ROM has no security hole, like happened to Freescale IMX6, so they release a new version of the CPU. Let's say that we can achieve some kind of trust boot. A trust boot is usually, we can consider, let's say, the first block of our code, let's say, in a Linux, in a U-boot world, is a first stage boot or MLO or whatever, as a trustable, and then we just check the validation of the signal for each component up to the file system when we are going to mount. Why? Okay. The reason I think that is obviously clear, but let's say that is not clear. We would like to avoid that our devices is compromised. Compromise is the risk that someone can technically download or install or change any part of the components that we considering, let's say, part of the system. Suppose that you have a payment terminal. Suppose that someone root your terminal. And suppose that after it routes your terminal, the fact can do a lot of stuff. Maybe it cannot run payment transaction because it cannot catch the PIN code, but it can try to attack the security components because there is always some protocol between the application processor and the security components. Or if you're using trust zone, it can try to... The trust zone, of course, is compromised because if security boot is done, even your trust firmware that is part of the trust chain is not considered secure anymore. So we need to, in some way, understand that our devices should be secure as much as we can. So let's keep this one because we need to go forward. There are some slides more that... So what happened? Why we need the security boot? Allora, and what happened in security boot? Okay, I don't know how much people knows have some experience of security boot, but all the modern C all the modern okay, start even from PC, but all the modern CPU in this context in this talk I'm talk with CPU most probably the embedded system like industrial embedded systems, payment terminal. It can be new or old generation of CPU. Let's take a reference some years ago or even now, because they reshape IMx6 in IMx6 Quad Plus are standard, like say Cortex A9 or Cortex A70 or Cortex whenever. They're most of the boot ROM inside the silicon mask or by the silicon support trust boot. In the this is starting this the starting of the idea of trust boot start most probably with the arrive in the market of mobile phone. If you remember, in 2011 there was like OMA4 that was a CPU presented in two different versions. One is was released to the market as let's say with some security features, and one was released as general purpose CPU for industrial market. Exactly in that time, they don't really understand what was the importance of security even in the industrial market. So at the time, TI was considered OMA4, release OMA4 as a non-secure boot. A possibility to have a non-secure boot was proper, but was a mistake because after, let's say, some months, so 1 year, already even Freescale or other companies start to have a way to security the trust. Things just Chinese vendor like Rockchip or Allwinner or any other silicon vendor, no of those silicon vendor has no concept of security boot. So it's something that even the silicon vendor start to understand. And this is a long time ago. Okay, basically what I want to avoid is okay, this is the least what you want not to have inside your system. So we need to in some way finding a way, even the physical attack, this is a bit different compared to other kind of terminal. So we have seen in the talk before, very interesting for me, that the payment terminal really something that you can change or you can hack and you can try, you know, to really hardware do hardware attack on top of it. So we need really thinking about security sometimes in some let's say some field. It's very important to considering that your device is not secure at all even from manipulations, okay? Just think about a pin on glass on and if someone can technically change or overlay your applications with something that let you show something that is like a pin and you try to insert your pin and your pin is let's say detected by the apps that is not your payment apps but is something that is fake on top of the glass. Of course this is not happening in payment terminal because there are some techniques to avoid the pin entry flow. Okay, this is an example of architecture how security boot is implemented, but very quick. You have some boot image like uBoot, you generate some keys to sign your bootloader, adding some header that in Freescale world is CSF. You basically flash the public key inside the IMX boot ROM, the eFuse. You verify that your fuse and your keys are coherent with your bootloader and you activate. Of course, if you activate a trusted boot and you don't do at least some kind of test on your devices screw up. So basically, you can throw from the window. Okay, so basically, boot ROM should check the signature. What does it mean? It basically means that it's simple. There is an algorithmic internal boot ROM that needs to compare the signature that you receive from the device that you apply with the expected result. And then you need some kind of host tools on side of your host to generate your keys. You need to flash your keys and you activate the security boot. I don't have time to go, let's say, in depth on IMX6 security boot because it's documented everywhere is you can find even in our open wiki all the information about the experience to use Security Boot in IMX6 CPU on using mainline kernel. So it's every step-by-step experience that I invite people that have some IMX6 architecture to let's say try it, but without enable it if they don't want to have the risk to screw up their board. But almost all the stuff can be done. There is an utility inside the U-boot that in IMX6 world is called, let's say it's a command, definition is hub status, that when you activate your trust chain, you flash your bootloader, you can understand if the keys and the image that you sign are coherent together. So if the hub status reports some event, it means that there is no coherence between the keys that you flash, and of course, if you flash some keys and you don't know where is your package in your file system, you screw up again your system because you cannot reflash again keys. Okay, this is the example. In the past, basically, it's still valid these assumptions. There are in the market some CPU that are considered secure. Security means that the surface on top of the CPU is a kind of mesh on top of the CPU. They have kind of internal storage on top of the CPU that we consider secured. And if we do proper layout, we can still obtain security boot on non-secure CPU. It means that the first stage boot, you know, all the CPU, as they call it, chain of boot. So, not chain of boot, it's like that preferable boot peripheral, okay? So, preferable boot peripheral, it means that you try some peripheral, it fail, go to the next and go to the next one. Some of them can bound one booting peripheral, or they can have two booting peripheral, but if you protect the layout properly, I don't know how much people know about the PCB layout, but let's say that these are BGA chips, BGA components. You can try to put your wire under the multiple layer of the PCB, and you can obtain this kind of security. Of course, on the top of your PCB, you need to still protect everything with mesh. Sorry, but the 50 minutes is including the question. No, it's okay. Okay, thanks. No. Okay, just so I have 50 minutes. Okay, good. So I have time. Okay, other problem that I found recently because I'm working on another, let's say, I call it payment terminal, but say proof of concept. Even the customer thinks that is really is working, still stable, but not, I don't think so. But recently, working with some payment terminal, I found that the way that Security Boot is implemented is kind of vendor style, because you know we have in this world we have Android BSP, and Android BSP usually does not really follow the latest version of the bootloader or latest version of the Linux implementation. So the way that how Google defined the trust boot of free scale things that the trust boot should be happen is not current sometimes. Even the experience that you have in our open wiki and the experience that I had with the customer are a bit different. So the idea is the same. The implementation can be, let's say, vendor by vendor. We hope that in the future we convert some standard way to activate, to manage Security Boot in order to not have like tens of different methods inside the COC. For COC is basically, I call it SOC, but it's a complex devices that is a CPU plus a peripheral and so on. Let's say OMA4, IMX6, COC, system on chip. Okay, the question if is Security Boot is enough for us? No, they don't guarantee any physical security, and then we need to understand if the device get compromised. So compromised physically, so it get open, for instance. So in a standard device that get open, if you have some keys that define the connection to some server, or you have some keys that are connected to the encryption PIN scheme of your payment transaction, you need to erase the key from the internal memory. And those are always connected to security chips that can real-time measure the mesh networks that are connected to the SIP using active tamper detections. What is an active tamper detection? It means that your mesh that is like things that is a wire, it can get open when you drill, or it can get compromised, but it doesn't work as a switch, as people can think. So it's connected or not connected when you drill, because it's too much simple. So no, basically it's active. Normally they have an input and output pin that they are able to understand if what you send is what you receive, and they have stricting timing. So if you cut the line, you need to interrupt the mesh on everything you get, the internal memory of the security CPU is lost. And they usually have like the storage, they usually store the keys to decrypt the internal storage of the chips itself. Okay, hardware tampering. Okay, I will just go through this one. Okay, I cannot show you some mesh network design, but basically things that you have a PCB and then you have okay, when you have a payment terminal, you have a glass, a display, and then you have the main PCB, the connection to the LCD, but you need to avoid, let's say, that the PCB in some ways can be, let's say, you can inject wire or whenever you want. There is some experience in the past for some Ingenico terminal, but what usually we do is create some mesh behind the main PCB and want some mesh on top. The mesh are like considered like another PCB or some flex that is covering basically the area that you want to protect. For instance, if you have a smart card, chip card, you need to protect the output of the reading of the card. So that is the basic idea. Okay. So we are happy? No, we are not. Even Google was not happy. So because we are still Android system, we need to ensure file system security. So what happened? The problem is simple. Suppose that you have a perfect security boot, you are able to remount, read/write some file system. The system cannot get power off. You can basically change or alter your file system, even if you. Alter the file system is basically is even if it's runtime. So even if the system understand in the second boot that you throw the file system, it's not is you already done basically, because there is times to compromise your system or even if is able to remount read/write. Most of the time you screw up your devices. So one of the denial of services that you can do in a payment terminal is to remount read/write the file system. Because as soon as you remount read/write, the devices is dead for the second boot, because some information is written in the file system itself and the devices screw up. So we need to, let's say, avoid that this can happen, and we need to be understand when it's happened. So basically what was introduced, what is used a lot by Google is some standard stuff that is in the Linux kernel, is the mVerify. Basically, we need to check the integrity of the file system. How is done? Okay, let's go through. Basically, we use standard like a tree when basically we go through for each node, For each node, we calculate an hash, and then we takes the intermediate node. We have again the calculation of the hash until we have the on the root node. We calculate the signature of the on the root. So it's just a step-by-step checking. So the idea behind this one is to understand if a block inside the file system get altered during the usage of the devices. So in this case, when we mount the file system, when we boot, or when we alterate during the usage, as soon as the block is get from the file system, we have an on-demand verifications during the disk access. Okay, it's not perfect, everything can be, but basically the idea in Android, because they understand that most of because why I say Android a lot of time, because most of the devices that are in the field are right now on a standard mobile phone, because we know the internals of Google devices, so how the security architecture is done in Android, so it's a good candidate to reuse in a security system for other purpose, not only for mobile phone. Okay, I think that how to set up, I think that we don't have a lot of times to go through, but basically you can generate offline your H3, you can build the verify table, you can sign it, and you just flash your system. All this procedure that seems that you can do in a standard Linux system, of course in Android this is very facilitated by the standard Android build system, so all these steps are automatically generated by Google when it creates the system image. I don't know if someone has experience in Android in general. Okay, good. No, not so good. Okay, now we need to go through because we have other problems. When you run some devices, even your laptop or any kind of devices, usually there are some kind of firewall, okay? Google or Android or payment terminals are not different from any kind of devices. They are defining standard rules for network. What is the real problem? The real problem is that those rules are not application dependent. So there is no way to define specific rules by application. For application type is something that I heard that we need to qualify what the application can do, it can type application is. So it's the same in this. So basically we need to restrict some application types to not do some traffic. So basically, as you can imagine, a payment application can only connect to the remote server, to the banks. It cannot go to any network, any kind of connections. All the connection through pass through a security trusted communication machine for the payment terminal, so it cannot connect where you want, but it needs to be routed inside this, let's say, VPN. And all the other application, if they are VA application, they need to receive some kind of restrictions. So all this stuff, even if seems is mapping on top of security. What are the security problem? And the security as other system, we are always interconnected. So we need to have updates, data backups, data synchronizations. We want to So did all this can generate any kind of flaw or an entire attack. So science, they can do two tricks. They introduce some kind of called net filter that let us to filter the traffic over the network inside the Linux kernel. And all this stuff, all this technique is even applied in payment terminal. The technique that we use are a bit more sophisticated. So we use the epitable, so the concept are the same, but of course the implementations need to be adapted on the context of this kind of devices. What usually is done is to confine application basically, so you know that any application that in Google is before it gets installed in the terminal, the application is some kind of sign. Okay, according to the signature or the sign of the applications, the application receives some kind of constraints. So system apps are not system apps only because they are signed with system keys, but even because when they get installed by the installee of the Android, the process that installs the application create a specific or let landed let land application in a specific domain. In this specific domain, we can create specific, let's say, API tables routing, API tables rules, and we can specific, let's say, I will talk before, after, a Linux domain. So, what is in simple word, what does it mean? So we need to create some rules that connect application, group of application, anything you want in some standard rules. So, we need to basically, in forward, we need to accept drop, return, or continue on the match or the rule that we have created. So, as I think that is, but basically, all the only things that we can understand this one is, is the same as before, but is isolate application, understand which application to do, which traffic we expect for them. In a payment, it's much more simple. Sometimes it should be defined in their, let's say, manifest, what they are going to do. And in that case, we can confine their network connections. Of course, we cannot allow incoming traffic. We are blocking some kind of protocol by default. So discovery is not so simple. The famous of DHCP, if you send a message, you don't declare exactly which operating system you are. There is some other rules on Chromium that you need to remove which kind of agent you are, but okay, so after that we need to understand what are considered legendary. On top of this, we need to declare and design our security system for payment terminal. We are much more, let's say, flexible because the rule can be defined by application. It's a bit different, so we can define a system where the application type, the application senior can define the rules where the application can the bound of the application is defined on the signature and is defined on the manifest itself. So the application is receiving, the application is vetted, the application applies some policy on top of it. And so we cannot talk about cgroup and namespace and we go straight to cLinux part. Okay, I think that nobody activates Linux in the laptop. We have some colleague in the company that has done it. It's not common. Usually we use a Parma or something like that. But in this world, Linux is the standard for security. Science, the Android 4.3. I think that every one of you know about disconnected access control. It means basically the first thing that we learn about Linux, about user, owner, and so on. So, cLinux define a mandatory access control, basically. Is a fine-grained way to define it's some fine-grained. It's not only about file system. It's about net, you can define cLinux rule about for networking, and you define cLinux rule for access to IOCTL internal of a device. So it's very powerful, and it should really define and the overall protection of your system. This is the reason. We don't want a trusted application can access some peripheral, for instance. We don't want some device connected to the internet. Anything there, or we don't want privilege escalation. So we don't want that any application can access your GPU or your I don't know security serial or whatever. Okay. So, what we do technically, we just define what is allowed. And we try to audit what is denied and to understand why is denied by the system and to create proper rules to confine and to create the proper rules inside the platform. Now I cannot, so I need to basically stop. Yes, okay. Yes. So question, almost everything will be put online about this part, say Linux in general, but there are more slides, so I try to go fast. Done.
Thank you very much, Michael. Since Michael was very sharp with the timing, we have room for questions. So if someone wish to ask something to Michael. No one?
Okay. I prefer not to have, but it's a rentable business. You can ask me if it's rentable, not business. Okay.
At the end, the first bootloader cannot be updated in the future.
Why?
If you have a secure boot.
Yes. Secure you resign boot. With the same keys that you signed the first one, you have updated.
So everything can be updated.
Yes. Perfect. Yes. Thank yes. Yes. There are some rules. Yeah, there is some kind of. Depends on how you certify the products. So if your trust chain, if you change how you assure the security boot, and you change some part of your assurance chain, so how the steps are done, in a payment terminal you need to recertify the product. So you need to upload a new documentation when you describe why you change your assurance boot and what problem was, and then you need to re-upload a new documentation, change the code accordingly, resubmit to PCI and get acceptance back. But yes, in general, of course, because it can be part of your problem, the security boot. It can be the bugs, the CVE, or whatever it could be in the bootloader itself. So yes, of course.
Well, thank you very much, Michael.
Okay.